stage. He is currently chairman and HOD in surgical oncology, Manipal Health, and consultant surgical and gyneco-onco and robotic surgeon. He is editor-in-chief, Springal Journal. Over to you, sir.
Thank you very much. It's a pleasure to be here. I always love to speak to obstetrician gynecologist because the breast cancer woman would not present to a surgical oncologist or a surgeon or a cancer center. And if any delay happens during the pregnancy, it has to be picked up at your level. So I'm very happy that, you know, instead of speaking to a surgeon and surgical oncologist or oncologist, where the identification detection of that woman doesn't happen, then there's no hearing. It's like beating my head on a wall. So I'm very happy. It's honor and pleasure to be here. I thank the organizing team having invited me and giving a nice topic, which is excellent. I bring warm regards from my cancer hospital. If you look back the Globocon data, we all knew that cervical cancer is number one. Now, no longer. Even in India, it is no longer. If you look back the National Cancer Registry, which has published the graph, it's like an X. The cervix is falling down. It fell down from 39 per 100,000. Now, it is at around 29. But in breast cancer, which was 17 per 100,000, when actually I came back from US and UK to India in year 2000, is now at around 33 per 100,000. So worldwide, even if you take both the genders, even though lung cancer, oral cancer is very common in males, breast cancer is number one across all the genders, and it's even high when it's to the woman. And if you look back the public-based cancer registry, Bangalore, Chennai, Delhi are number one, highest of all of them. And the worst part about Bangalore is the most young women, third decade, are actually in Bangalore, which is very, very sad. We constitute more than 50% of young women with breast cancer worldwide. What is difference of a breast cancer in India to the abroad, US, UK, and Western world? The peak usually is at around fifth decade, but in India, you have a very peculiar reason that around third decade. Now imagine, look at what happens in the Bangalore. Most of them software techie, they're studying, women delay marrying, delaying a pregnancy, having a first child before 30, and 30, there is already a peak. I have phenomenal amount of young women who are very young, either not married or about to marry, starting a career, or just married, not had a children, has a breast cancer. So in India, young women, a decade early it is, which is very, very unfortunate. So you can see that women with 30 years is very common in India, which means that's a fertile age. You know, that's when they have their first child. So most of their breast cancer happen during this. So imagine what's going to the impact on the woman and also on the child. The importance of early detection is why? If you identify them in stage one, most of them see 10 years beyond and cured. 99% of them are cured. But on the contrary, the moment you change a stage, remember, any breast cancer, if it is palpable, she comes to you when there is a palpable lump, already the total survival changes. It is no longer an early breast cancer, it's already in advance, which means screen detection, identification, sonon, memo is something which is very, very important. Now, what do you really mean by PABC, pregnancy-associated breast cancer? Most of the women think that, you know, the misnomer is, oh, it is only during pregnancy. No, that state of low immunogenicity, so the baby and the fetus can be tolerated, even though they share a different antigen, anticity blood group, to carry on for 9 months and not excluded is a low immunogenicity state that continues even during the lactation. So any breast cancer diagnosed during gestation, also 1 year up to postpartum, is actually a PABC. Now, what do you see the incidence? You can see that way back in 1963, it was 16 per 100,000. In 2002, it actually went back very high to 37.4. But remember, this census was in 2002. See the phenomenal increase during the breast cancer, during the pregnancy. But now, between 2002 till now, there has been an increasing incidence, 2.4 per year. And during the, around the time of delivery, it is about 10.6. And then during the lactation, it is 15. So remember, don't stop. Like during antenatal, just breast examination, then lactation, breast examination to just look nipple inversion, inversion doesn't stop our responsibility. It is something more. Now, what is the reason? Why do we have this two-prong attack? This has been explained very well, actually, by the Lancet, where one reason might be that increasing age of pregnancy. You look back way back in 1970, where it was mean age of all the birth and mean age of the first birth. We started somewhere around 20, and now we are closely going to 27. And in UK, the top 10 first pregnancy is at 30. So imagine, that is the place where we are in Bangalore, where breast cancer is the highest women between 30 to 40. Don't think that only a postmenopausal lady will have. A painless lump in a lady who is also premenopausal could be a malignancy, and you need to look at that particular area. Now, there are many theories there. This is something which is to be kept in mind. A nulliparous woman, pregnant and involuting stage, where you have a perimenopausal and menopause where cyst and the fibroadenosis replaces. Look back that if you have a mutation, the way it is corrected in a nulliparous woman and the way it is in the pregnant involution is totally different. The mutation keeps accumulating in a pregnant woman and it carries on to the first year. That's why a breast cancer is highest manifested due immediately within the 8 to 10 months after delivery during the lactation. That's where you could miss. This is something very important to understand. Misnomer if you think there is a lump felt for a breast cancer during pregnancy. No. Inflammatory breast cancer, which is highest during pregnancy and lactation, and breast cancer during lactation will not show a lump. It will be general, woody, indurated lump with thickening of the skin. And look back, most of the breast cancers during pregnancy that are referred to me across the town come very late. Not because it is very aggressive during pregnancy, because they think, oh, it is a probably a lactation abscess, mastitis. Let me give a course of antibiotic. 2 weeks gone, third week gone, and then fourth week you do an ultrasound. They don't go to a non-specialized center of Sonomemo. Then by the time they come there, at least 3 to 4 months late, where there is a stage migration. With each stage migration, the woman loses 50% of her life chance of being alive. So beware. Don't ever put it as a breast abscess. Don't try to look for a lump. I always ask, oh, it's painless pain. Remember, any change in the breast, because there is natural change of the physiology of the breast during pregnancy and lactation. So high induction of suspicion is something very important. Can you see this? This is a lady who is 27 years, who was referred to me. In her second trimester, there is no lump palpable. Remember, in inflammatory breast cancer, never you will have a lump. A erysipelas rash, painless, not tender, no fever, just skin thickening, no lump found. That is already a stage 3B, LABC, locally advanced breast cancer. Keep this photo in mind. So high index of suspicion of asking a good ultrasound and guided ultrasound core biopsy is an answer not to miss a breast cancer and delay it and harm the child and also the woman. Now if you look back, how does the biology of breast cancer during pregnancy vary from normal breast cancer? This is a very landmark paper which is there. If you look back, these women are delayed. They come in stage 2 and stage 3. It is not because it is their fault. They have been regularly going to their obstetrician because there is no high index of suspicion. That's why. And they tend to be ignored until they become node positive. Younger women come with higher stage node positive. So all three deadly combination in a woman who is already running through a happy event, which is a pregnancy, and a happy child who is going to come back, who is going to change the whole life. But it's a disaster in a triangle of boom we have. And biologically, they become higher grade, high proliferative index, high HER2-neu positive, and unfortunately, they become almost receptor negative. So don't always think they're estrogen dependent, which changes. This is a beautiful algorithm, which everybody must keep in mind to understand. There is a lot of myth which needs to be busted for pregnancy-associated cancer. They think pregnancy, breast cancer, abortion. No. Pregnancy, breast cancer, chemo cannot be given, wrong. Pregnancy, breast conservation is ruled out. It has to be mastectomy. False. Oh, we can't do a breast conservation because radiotherapy cannot be given. Radiotherapy can be delayed safely as much as 5 to 6 months. You can wait for pregnancy to get over. This is a beautiful algorithm. Less than 12 weeks and more than 12 weeks. See, less than 12 weeks, there is no safe chemotherapy around that time, but beyond 12, you can use all the chemo safely. Then you consider a mastectomy because the golden time of remaining 5 to 6 months of radiation is lost. And radiation is compulsory when you do a breast conservation. Only you terminate the pregnancy, extraordinary. Only if their poor performance status or very aggressive, very prognosis is very bad. Rarely, 99.99% never a termination is required in breast cancer during pregnancy. You can have a cured mother, happy mother, and also a healthy child without any congenital abnormalities. Suppose they are beyond 12 weeks, you see, are they operable at presentation, stage 1, stage 2, go ahead and do the surgery. You can actually do a sentinel lymph node biopsy without a radiocolloid. You can do a breast conservation. Chemo can be started safely, any chemo, and radiation after completion of pregnancy and delivery. If it is locally advanced, you can give chemo first, downsize it, do a surgery what is appropriate, and then go back and do that. That's why it is very important to have an early breast detection. 3 component you must teach every human: breast self examination the moment they are 20, clinical breast examination at least once a year and later 3 years, and mammography the moment they are 40. Remember, young woman, mammography is not sensitive. You have to ask sonomammogram. Never ask a mammogram alone. Always mammogram and a sonomammogram. Sonomammogram doesn't mean memo. Dedicated special ultrasound interpreted. Ultrasound of breast is not same as sonomammogram. It should be done together, interpreted together always. Why? By just doing breast self-examination, 18.8% of mortality comes down. If you add your clinical examination, they don't come to a surgeon or anybody, with to you, because they trust the gynecologist and obstetrician. If you just do a proper examination, 24% reduction in mortality. Forget treatment, just if you do these things for those women. Remember, breast self-examination is not a simple thing. It's very important to understand. Tell the patient to download, perform by doctor, annually at 40, and more frequently in high risk. I always feel women fail to understand there is an area called axillary tail, axilla, inframammary fold. A lady who does a breast self-examination commonly ignores and comes with breast cancer in inframammary fold and upper outer quadrant axillary tail. So you must educate them how to do this particular area. Educate what is the boundary of this and examine pattern. I always see, how do you do breast self-examination? Take 2 fingers and try to palpate. Please never do that. It is a normal breast tissue felt as lump. Then you have a crazy lady every day coming and you are panicked, they are panicking. If you press something between 2 skin, you will feel a lump. So you must know what is the right way. This is the right technique. Pad of finger technique. 3 middle finger held at metacarbophalangeal joint. Pads in a circle. Light to feel a big lump. Medium to feel cyst. And deep to feel a deep seated tumor at the pectoral fascia. In circle, in different area, and remember, we always, when we do colposcopy, we say, oh, don't put acetovite and don't run, please put the clock for 2 to 3 minutes. Put the clock. 3 minutes minimum. Average time in busy clinician like us, spend 1.8 and the tumor misses an opportunity. And do a complete examination explainer with a pad of finger. This is the right way to do it. Right screening tool, this is a link. Give to your patient in WhatsApp, tell them download. All the beautiful way of doing your own breast self-examination is available there. Next, mammography for a woman above 40. Because randomized control trial showed, if you just do this, women's lives are saved. And very important, a badly performed mammogram, not seeing a mammogram, seeing a report. You know, we have a habit of treating the case files, not the patient. Patient is sitting, all the report, oh, normal, CT, MR. There is a big lump sitting there. Somebody has missed it. So see the patient, don't read the case files. Don't read the report. Maximum problem in reporting mammogram unless they are trained. See yourself. Is it a good quality? What is a good quality mammogram? Unless the interface of the pectoral fascia, muscle and breast is not seen. If axilla not seen oblique way, don't accept that. Send them back. You must see the inframammary fold. Axilla, interface of pectoral is muscle, chest wall and the breast. Otherwise, it is not a properly performed mammogram. Send them back. These are the myths. Oh, high radiation. One x-ray gives you more. You walk in 11 o'clock, 12 o'clock with your sunglass in the sun, it gives more radiation. A woman would need to undergo 1,000 mammogram to even have some x-ray. Once a year, nobody has lived beyond 110 years in the world, so they can't have more than that. It causes cancer dissemination. Never. It's very painful. No. When I was doing a breast surgery fellowship in Pittsburgh, we had a rule. Every woman does a mammogram, she comes out, we used to ask. It was painful, yeah, very painful, press my bread. Then I say, now take the oath. What is the oath? I know it is painful, I'm not going to tell anybody it is painful. I will tell to all the women it is not painful. That is the oath we used to make them take and go out, that saves. One wrongly told painful will, all whole community, whole house will not come back and all of them are prone for risk of late identification of breast cancer. And remember, all lumps detected on mammo is not cancer, 0.02%. You do 1,000 mammogram, 0.2 people or 2 of them can actually have abnormality. So tell them not. Mammography is not done. I always tell my ladies, mammography is not done to identify breast cancer, treat or knock off your breast. It is done to prove you don't have cancer, enjoy your life. Free currency, prepaid currency, enjoy next 1 year, no fear of cancer. What is the biggest problem in life? Fear. Remove the fear by doing a mammogram, you don't have cancer. So at this moment, and for 1 year it is valid. So remember, this is the beauty of screening. You don't have to call them back. Very few of them need it for you to do. Suppose a lady in your clinic, pregnancy or anybody, comes with a lump, how would you approach? Common mistake, MRI, FNAC. That is the biggest crime you commit. Please never do that. The cost you spend on an MRI, which is not ever required in an evaluation of breast lump, can finish the entire treatment. FNAC is more dangerous. Nobody can identify what it is. You do FNA and give false report, they'll come in advanced. These two, if you see this word, no, MRI breast, FNAC, run away from there, catch them and change that. If your radiologist says, I'll do a FNAC, say no. Only core biopsy. Please don't do MRI. Do a good mammogram and ultrasound. How do you? Triple assessment you must do. And second mistake is pain. Pain, 0% assessment of cancer. When somebody calls me, I want to urgently see, I have a lump, some relative of me has a doctor calls a gynecologist, I say, painful, painless. They say, painless. I say, okay, next month you come, relaxed, we can see weekend. Painless, I say, please come tomorrow. So remember this, this is something very important. So woman thinks there is no pain, so I don't have to worry about cancer. There are a lot of abnormalities which are not cancer, please keep that in mind. Triple assessment, clinical examination by you, 40-year mammography and ultrasound, if it is young, ultrasound, core biopsy, no FNAC. FNAC has ruined a lot of patients and families. Don't do that. And second thing is, you young woman has a dense breast, do an ultrasound. Gold standard is this. 95% of the time it saves lives by doing this. Look at when a woman does breast self-examination, what is the size? Clinical examination, where it comes, mammography, where it comes. Don't you want to pick it up in the last phase where you can do a breast conservation to that lady, save her breast, do a daycare procedure, do a central lymph node, no lymphedema, they go back happily. They may not need chemo at all if you identify early. So a good mammogram, nipple areola seen, posterior pectoralis major seen, medial lateral view, see the axilla and the lymph node seen. If this is not, send it back to the diagnostic center wherever you are done. Tell them, please learn over or please send it like this. And unless there is a Birard scoring, don't accept that report. Just send it back. So you must know this. Ultrasound should be done in an young woman with lot of cysts. Pregnancy, ultrasound is very important. Galactosyl, cyst, complex cyst, inflammatory breast cancer can be easily identified by you. What is the difference between ultrasound breast and sonomammogram? This is sonomammogram. So every nook and corner roadside ultrasound is not. So we should know this is the place to do, and good done can always identify them well. Document it well. Know, is it a cyst, a simple aspiration, complicated cyst that needs evaluation, it could be a papillary tumor, or a galactosyl and abscess. Second thing, if a lady has a breast abscess, if a surgeon of your colleague says, I'll put an incision, never do that. Nobody now puts an IND for a breast abscess. 99% of them are ultrasound guided aspiration or ultrasound guided pigtail, and remember, very few, otherwise there will be non-healing sinus, puckered, contracted bed. So all are now managed by ultrasound in a various way. It could be fibroadenomas, carcinoma, length is bigger than the breadth, so you must look at this particular area. What I want to know is, when you have a nipple discharge, it could be ductectasia papilloma, high frequency ultrasound of nipple areola complex, you must ask, not just this. Most of them could be papilloma with blood discharge. And this is how an assessment is. For the want of time, I can't put, you can take a photo of this. Please never ever ask an MRI. I run lot of courses for BSOG, Bangalore Society of Obstetric Gynec. How to do an office-based core biopsy yourself. Never ask an FNAC, it cannot distinguish in situ with invasive. You will have lot of false positive, false negative, wrong report, they go home. Most of the women who comes in advanced disease to me are somebody who is their gynecologist, ask an FNAC, see the report of FNAC, happily send to them. Never ask FNAC. I always say you learn core biopsy yourself. This is an 800 rupees gun. I run courses for BSOG, how to do yourself. Very simple and easy. Don't allow your surgeon or somebody else to do. Press once, press twice. Press one, press twice. Now look back the next one. First press, second press. Small local anesthesia, patient can be on ecosperin, doesn't matter. Just go in, press that gun out. One shot, it takes a beautiful core and comes out. You will never miss a breast cancer. A phylloids and a fibroadenoma can be distinguished. A breast, see that the core comes. Very easy, these videos are available. You can run a course and please do it yourself. Please don't do MRI. MRI is not recommended unless they have a prosthesis, breast augmentation or BRCA positivity. Please don't do this. It's a waste of time. All the trials say it's of no use. Second thing is, don't get all the lymph nodes in the axilla removed. Do a sentinel lymph node and then they avoid all the lymphedema and everything in the patient. It's very important that this woman should not be denied these things. Daycare, small, no drains, subcuticular suture for you to do. So last 3-4 slides, how do you manage? Main message. Treatment should be performed by multidisciplinary involving a fertility and obstetrician. What are the concerns with chemo? We have all these concerns telling maternal, fetal. Remember, I'll put this slide, this is evidence-based. Doxorubicin, epirubicin, mitoxantrone can be safely given. So don't worry, they cannot be denied. Large studies, long safe data, studied over 20, 30 years, both maternal and fetal, no problem. Treatment of these patients are managed by MDT and based on the ESGO and INCIP guideline. And what does this guideline say? There is a very safety, I have just three slides, I'll end it. It is very safe to do this among the 14 meta-analyses. I put all the studies and it clearly came back to this algorithm. No woman loses her child, no abortion required, no woman loses her breast, and no woman should be denied sentinel lymph node. All three, which is a right of a lady for a quality of life and cosmesis, can be done. Second thing is, if they have been breast cancer survivor, is conception safe? So 14 meta-analyses confirmed that if that lady had a breast cancer, immediately after 2 to 3 years, definitely it is safe. Beauty is, a woman who conceives after breast cancer has a lesser chance of recurrence and they live long. Tell this to your woman. So it's very, very important. It's extremely important, this point. Healthy mother concept. 40% reduction in recurrence if they successfully have pregnancy, even after treating a breast cancer, because it has got a low immunogenicity, it helps them. So to conclude, triple assessment by you, biopsy by you, not doing wrong mammogram, not spending money on MRI, doing a right thing for that patient is very important. There is a beautiful ray of a child, healthy mother, healthy child, and there. Please remember this in your mind next time when you see. Don't wait for lump. No pain, no cancer. Just simple redness, fullness, thickening. Always ask ultrasound of the breast and guided core. Believe me, you'll never get into medical legal problem. You'll never get into guilty feeling. That mother and father and that child will never curse you in your life. So it's extremely important to understand this area. Thank you. That's my beautiful, lovely daughter and my wife and my daughters. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Thank you, sir. It was a wonderful session. Any questions from the audience?
Yeah, can you be a little loud? I'm not able to.
So patient was 65 years old and routine...
65 year young.
Yes, old. And
we don't use the term old, 65 young. When we reach 65, we'll know it is very young.
Yes, sir. And it was mammography report was microcalcification. There was no lump, nothing. Later, followed by 1 year later.
Okay, I'll just put this point. A clustered pleomorphic microcalcification,
yes,
in absence of a lump usually is a DCIS. Ductal cell carcinoma in situ, stage zero, which is going to become invasive in next 2 years. US and mammographic guided core biopsy and lump excision would solve the problem for that lady. So microcal is most dangerous. If somebody says nothing is required, don't listen. Microcal, always do a mammographic guided core biopsy. It's a DCIS. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. It was a wonderful session.